Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It's a great joy to me to see so many folks who are already tuning in on our broadcast on Facebook Live. Church family, I love you. We love you. And it's great to be able to worship the same Lord and the same Spirit and to know that He is keeping us safe and that His love surrounds us all. And so today, let us sing of our joy to Him and our trust in Him. There is a bulletin that you should have received by email. Also, it's available on our Facebook page. And our opening hymn today will be How Firm a Foundation. And so let us sing this great hymn of our faith. In those times that we are afraid, this is a hymn where rather than our praying to God, it is a word of assurance from God to us. And so let what God says in this hymn to you bring comfort to your heart. How firm a foundation, we'll sing all the verses.
Spirit of the Lord is, there's the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. And you may be seated. Good morning, church, and I just want to thank everyone for tuning in on Facebook and joining us on this beautiful Sunday for worship. Worshiping our amazing God, and then as you're sitting down, as you're grabbing your coffee and your breakfast, I just want to have a few announcements. So Sunday, August 23rd, we will we plan on having blessing of the backpacks with the children. And so we're setting that up. We're getting everything into play. So we will send out more info here soon. But keep that on your calendar. Sunday, August 23rd. It's the Sunday before school. So be on the lookout for more info from either Nathan or Marissa or whoever we have in the office. And also, Wednesday Night Live is going to continue on Wednesdays at 5:15 with Nathan and sometimes Maggie. It's a great ministry that we do, and just make sure you tune in for that for any updates, any pray for some prayers and some music and some and fun times with our awesome and funny pastor. Also, Thursday's Women's Bible Study with Emily. Like I said, it's on Thursdays at 11:15 via Zoom. And if it's a great ministry. My wife has said it's an amazing time. And so if you haven't came yet, I'm sure you can still join. I'm sure it's, you know, you can come in whenever. And so just get with Emily with that, and she'll help you. She'll hook you up with, you know, on your laptop, on your phone, whatever you have to do to join that amazing ministry as well. And also, so big news, the Wednesday morning Bible study, the breakfast on Wednesday mornings at 7 is starting back up in the Wesley Center. You're going to be spaced out, but listen, I have been told by Nathan, bring your own food and drink, and that means coffee. There will be no coffee for you guys at 7 a.m. I know it's tough. Swing by McDonald's or something, grab you some coffee. And also, it'll be he'll have it on Google Meet as well for those that cannot make it or just not comfortable with it. But Wednesday morning Bible study at 7, meeting in the Wesley Center starting this Wednesday, Nathan?
Already started.
Oh, look at there. I'm a week late. But yes, Wednesday morning Bible study. And also, drive-in worship at 11 is in the church parking lot. We've been having that for a couple of weeks. If you're still going to the grocery outlet, you're missing it. You're missing a good time. So do not go there. We've been having it here for a couple of weeks now. It's a great time if you just want to see everybody. Stay in your vehicles. And finally, we want to thank you for continuing to support the church during these crazy and unknown times. And remember that you can keep on doing so by either mailing it in or also online on our website. So make sure you keep doing that, and we're just so grateful for all of you faithful and generous members. And so now I want to kick it over to the ladies for some special music.
Oh.
Thank you for blessing us with that, ladies. That was wonderful. Wonderful way to start off our beautiful Sunday morning. As we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, let us remember these. Joanne Brandenburg, Roy Sheffer, Karen Vickery, Glenn Barber, Nancy Hearn, Christine Yoshikawa, and Howard Herring. With these prayer concerns and others, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you that we can find our worth in you, and you alone. Thank you for sending the Holy Spirit to comfort and to guide us. As we face our fears of today, remind us of who you are and who we are in you. You are strong and courageous, the Almighty King and loving Father. You've said in your word that as we wait upon you, we can take courage. Because we know you are with us, you are for us, and you will empower us with courage and the strength we need for whatever is placed before us. Remind us of who you have created us to be and what you have empowered us to do. Lord, you are the courageous one. And so right now we wait upon you. As we face fear and intimidation, we trust that you will keep your promise. We trust that we are who you say we are. We trust that you will give us the strength and the courage we need to face every circumstance. And we trust that victory is on the other side. We boldly declare that we will not let fear or intimidation stop us from being obedient. Help us to endure, Lord. Give us grace. You're a good Father and you are faithful. We trust you. We pray this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
For the last few months, it has been a great joy to hear wonderful testimonies of the goodness of God and the work of God in the life of many of the members of our church. Each week, we've had somebody share where they have seen God working in their life. And this Sunday, it's a great joy for me to have John Donaldson come and share with us. Coach John Donaldson is the coach of the Marianna High School varsity football team, and he's also a great Christian man. He is a national champion. He played with Florida State when they won a national championship. I know you were happy about that. Yeah, there's a few other fans out there, but I especially appreciate that Coach Donaldson not only teaches football, but more importantly, teaches young men how to be great men and molds their lives and cares for them and mentors them. And so it's my great joy to invite John Donaldson to come and share.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Let me raise this up. I believe this is first time I've ever spoken with the whole crowd behind me, so bear with me. Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you for asking me to be here and share some things that are on my heart, and I appreciate the opportunity. I'm certainly in debt to you and the things that you've done for me and my family and the kids that I serve. If you see my folks, please tell them that I got up here and spoke in front of church today, and tell my mom that I did a good job, and my dad that I had on a coat and I looked good, and just don't tell them that nobody was here to see it. Okay, hold that part in secret. But I want to talk a little bit about what's on my heart with the times that we're in today. And a few years back, I had the pleasure of working with an administrator who was also a member of our congregation. And you guys will certainly remember Miss Connie Brisolera. And there are many, many things that I'll never forget about Connie. And a lot of things that I learned from her. She had a great, easygoing demeanor every day at work, and she had an unforgettable laugh, if you remember that. If you could hear her laugh among 1,000 people, you knew who it was. But she had a saying that she often used, and I came fond of. And the quote, I guess we call it a quote, was, "Blessed are the flexible." And she would say that at meetings, and she began to attach that to her emails, and it's just something kind of stuck with me. Given the place that she and I worked together, I appreciated the quote, and I've repeated it over the years. And you know, any of you that deal in the business of human beings know that things are subject to change by the minute. So it's just something I've kept with me. But since mid-March, I think about that quote every day, if I don't say it to someone every day. Never in my life have I seen our entire world change so drastically and hold that way for so long. Certainly we all in every industry or every role, we've learned the value and actually the necessity of being flexible. And going forward from the day, we will continue to adapt and to continue to overcome and change our course and exercise our flexibility. We learned in school that when a crisis hits, we usually respond in one of three ways. We're going to fight, flight, or freeze. And worry, anxiety, and insecurity can replace our peace and joy and patience. Instead of being full of faith, we can become full of fear if we're not careful. We hold on to things so tightly that we cannot control instead of surrendering it to God. And we hold on to things too tightly, we start to get the old white knuckles. And the funny thing is about the white knuckles is that we often are the last people to see them. Usually they're observed by the people that are around us. Corrie Ten Boom said, "Hold on to things lightly, otherwise it hurts when God pries your fingers open." Like many of you, I personally struggled with holding on to the processes and the ways in which I've always done things, or the world's just worked. As a ball coach, it's difficult for me to give up, you know, my calendar, things that I want to do in a sequential order, things that I believe in. It's been difficult. In my field of education right now, there's so much unknown. We read about it every day. There's so much anxiety and fear and change with the upcoming weeks of the upcoming school year. Just a few weeks ago, my wife recognized my white knuckles as I watched a 5-hour Zoom meeting trying to figure out, watch the state waffle back and forth on whether we're going to have athletics or not. And she just had to tell me that, look, you just got to bear down and control what you can control and give the rest to God. And she was right. And in the last few weeks, I've tried and tried to do better. It is my hope that we all can not only find peace in the next few months as we face these challenges, but we also remember to stop and recognize the joy in our lives and the people in our lives. When I look at my life, I'm so thankful for the good Lord, for the people he put in my life, the great people he put in my life, and he put them in my life at the exact same time that I needed them. And he continues to do that. Every year I have kids, or I have parents, or I have coaches that there are people I've never met before. They're unlike people I've ever met before, and I learn from them, and I'm thankful for that. Think about how different your life would be if God eliminated one person, or maybe two, from your past. In closing, I just want to thank my church for the love and support it's given me and my family over the years, and I look forward for us all being together in this room one day. And remember, blessed are the flexible, and thank you.
Thank you, Coach. Let's now sing with all of our heart a prayer to our God. Stand by me, and he will stand by us.
When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. Thank you.
Our reading from the Holy Scriptures today comes from the Gospel according to Matthew. And if you have a Bible at your home or if you have a phone available, I invite you to turn in your Bible to Matthew chapter 14. And we'll be reading today from the 22nd verse through the 33rd verse. Listen for God's word as we share it together. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 through 33. Immediately, he, that is Jesus, made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and started walking on the water and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong winds, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me!" And Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated, please. Throughout the summer, we've had weekly reflections from the Gospels of Jesus' point of view of life being a new way for us to learn, both by precept and example, how we might live a Christ-shaped, life-giving way of life. It's easy for us to think that Christianity means that we have just had a conversion experience, that we have a Christian identity, that we maybe even belong to a church or go to church on a regular basis. The Gospels teach us that to be a Christian is to allow Jesus to be our true master, for him to be our guide, for him to be our example, for our whole life, our mindset, our actions, our purpose for living, to be shaped in the image and likeness of Christ. And so it is Jesus who, week in and week out, we've looked to find new skills, new tools for living. We have all kinds of ways that we live in this life, but being a Christian means that we learn to do life the Jesus way. And many of the things that we have learned in life that are valuable have been learned by modeling somebody who does them well. It's a great joy to have Coach Donaldson with us today. And he is a fantastic coach, but he also was once a player, and he himself was coached, and he had the opportunity to be coached by one of the greatest college football coaches of all time, Bobby Bowden. I imagine that Coach Donaldson learned a few things from Bobby Bowden, probably many a thing, right? And not only about coaching, but also about being a leader of young men. One thing that Coach Donaldson and Coach Bowden both put at the center of the way they are coaches is that they put their faith and they put human beings before winning football games. And that's something that we treasure about them, even those of us who might not happen to be Florida State fans, right? Can appreciate that that sense of priority, that people and God are more important than football, and that makes for better football, right? Right now, we are able to enjoy this broadcast because we have wonderful people in our booth, in our balcony. We've got Chuck and Nikki Davis, who do all the TV stuff, and we've got Tony Capps, and he does the sound stuff, and they do a tremendous job. But also, what you can't see as you're watching this broadcast is there are other people up there. We've got Taylor Young up there, and he's learning, right? And he's helping, and he's learning by doing. We also have, for the first time in a while, we've got Christian Poole up there. Man, I have missed Christian. And he's sitting right alongside, and they are learning by doing. They're looking over the shoulder of people who know how to do something well, and they are absorbing that capacity so they can serve in the same way. That's what Christianity is. Allowing ourselves to look over the shoulder of Jesus and to be mentored by Jesus, to be shaped by Jesus, to set aside our way of being and allow our way of being to be the Jesus way. And don't we need that right now? Don't we need to learn how to live in this world the Jesus way rather than our own way in a time of tremendous fear? We're all concerned about COVID and how it's affecting our world and our lives, our economy. I'm getting into a point in my ministry now where a big part of my ministry is checking in with people who have become COVID positive or who have loved ones who are sick with COVID and facing the potential of losing their lives, or people who are sick and awaiting the results of a COVID test and living in that anxiety. It's a real crisis, and it is a scary time. How does a Christian handle crisis and danger? Things that are scary. How does a Christian live in a scary world when scary things happen? I know in my own pastoral ministry, I sometimes see the mentoring of those who have taught me how to be a pastor sort of pop out. I was very blessed to have a mentor named Lawson Bryan. He is now the bishop of the South Georgia Conference. And Lawson Bryan never freaked out ever. No matter what happened, he always had an easy, pleasant, positive disposition. He was raised in a chaotic, alcoholic home. And as a child, he was the peacemaker. And he had to make everything okay. And so whatever might happen in church life was nothing compared to what he had seen as a child. And he taught me, both by word and more importantly by example, to be a non-anxious presence. The pastor has got to be the person who doesn't freak out. I had another wonderful mentor named David Warren, and he had sort of an opposite reaction. Whenever a crisis happened, he would spring into action. He would turn anxiety into activity. I can remember being in staff meeting one day, and we got word that a beloved church member named Newton Yon had passed away, and that his body had been found at his home, and that was horrendous. But immediately, Brother David sprung out of his chair and said, "Come on, Nathan!" And we were over there in 2 minutes. And David turned crisis into action in a way that meant that no matter what was going on in people's lives, he was always there. He was there immediately. You know, I hope to model the best of those kinds of responses in my own life and ministry. And I'm sure that the disciples, after experiences like the one that we find in this passage, when they faced other crises in their life, could go back to those times when everything was fearful and everything was chaotic and everything was dangerous, and they could say, this is how Jesus acted and this is how he taught us to act. And today, Jesus is with his disciples in the midst of a terrifying circumstance. And he teaches them about a fundamental human reality. He teaches them about dealing with fear. If you're going to be human in this life, you're going to have to learn how to manage fear and anxiety. The Bible teaches us hundreds of times, as Jesus teaches us in this passage, do not fear. Be not afraid. We oftentimes overlook the fact that the Bible also teaches us that there are times that we should be afraid. How many times does Jesus say, beware, be on guard, take care? Sometimes Jesus puts it this way, don't be afraid of this, rather fear this other thing. Sometimes the question isn't about whether we should be afraid, but whether our fear is rightly placed. A person who truly fears God will fear nothing else. The truth is that fear and anxiety are part of life. Jesus gives us power not to live in a world that has no fear or a world that has no reason to fear, but to overcome fear and to live in confidence in the face of a dangerous world. Jesus says, take heart, take heart. Now, most people don't know that the word courage that we use so often means take heart. It comes from a Latin word, cur. The cur is the heart. To have courage is to have a strong heart. And God made us so that when we become afraid, we become stupid. God made us so that in the face of a terrible threat, we don't think. We respond. See, because for most of human history, the threats that we face are physical threats. And when you're about to be eaten by a saber-toothed tiger, or you're about to be cut up with a sword, or being chased by a bear, that's not the time for strategic thinking. Amen? So God designed our brain so, as Coach Donaldson said, when we face a threat, we're either going to run away, or we're going to freeze, or we're going to fight. And those are simple things. They're instinctual things. But God also designed us with a highly developed brain that is designed to be able to think 10 steps ahead. That's the top of the brain. The reptilian brain is in the bottom of our brain, the stem of our brain. And when we're calm, we're able to think things through and to be rational. What's unique about a human being, particularly in the modern world, is that we can think about threats that are not immediate, and then we can fear them as if they are an immediate crisis, and we can live in a constant state of anxiety about not only the things that are dangerous, but the things that might be dangerous. And so most of us think that we see the world from a rational point of view, but all human beings rationalize back from their fears. And we make big mistakes. We make big mistakes. Now, Christians sometimes will think that the reason that a Christian should be able to overcome fear is because we have pretended that dangers in this world aren't real, or we have a theology that tells us that because we're Christian, God will keep us from the dangers of this world or allowing them to affect us. But the Bible teaches us that the dangers of this world are real. And Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble. Not you might have trouble, you will have trouble. And the disciples in that boat, when the storms came, knew that they were in real trouble. As fishermen on the Sea of Galilee, they had known people who had died in similar storms. It is a false theology that says, oh, everything's just going to be okay. It's going to work out somehow. Sometimes bad things happen. Even when we have trusted God completely, it's just the truth. It's just the way that it is. I saw a church that had a sign for their in-person worship, and underneath it said the sermon title was Faith Over Fear. Now, there are lots of churches that have gone back to in-person worship for good reasons, and I would never criticize any of them. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying that if the reason they went back to in-person worship is because they have a faith that causes them not to think that God's going to allow people to get sick, then that is a faulty theology. And many, many churches have seen lots and lots of people get sick when they come back to worship, thinking God's just going to make everything okay. And in our church, we had the confidence that even if we had to do ministry in different ways, that Christ would sustain his church, and that the practices and ways of being church that we have always employed were not what make us the people of God. That God would support his ministry, and he would pay the bills, and that with or without a building or an in-person worship service or an offering plate, that God would see us through and allow us to expand the work that he called us to. And God has done that. We didn't have to play pretend, because we can trust in the miracle working power of God and still acknowledge that there are real threats in this world and that life is difficult, and in the end all of us are going to die, because we serve a God who took flesh and died on a cross and then was raised from the dead. We don't have to fear even death, and if we're not afraid of death, then we need to fear no other threat. God has given us the resources to be clear-eyed about the threats of life as it is, and to have courage in the face of difficulty. The reality is, if there was no danger, there would be no courage. It's only crisis and challenge that reveal that God has given us a heart of confidence and faith. Courage is only seen in the face of a threat. It is revealed in the midst of crisis. So for a Christian, our confidence doesn't come from our capacity to manage risk. For Christian, our confidence comes from our confidence in God and God's faithfulness. Our confidence is not in ourselves. Our confidence is not in our circumstance. Our confidence is that whatever happens, God is with us. Jesus didn't say, take heart. Do not be afraid. Everything will be fine. Don't worry. Storms are, people don't really drown. No, he didn't say any of that. Jesus said, take heart. It is I. He reminded them of his presence and the presence of Jesus Christ as God's sign of his care for us. And the empty cross is the sign of the measure of his faithfulness. Even in the midst of the cruelty of the world. I've shared this story before. This one is worth telling again. So if you remember me sharing it, then please be patient. And if you haven't, it's a good one, okay? Many years ago, it's been a while now, a dozen years ago, I was 33 years old. I was feeling not well. I was very healthy at that time. I was in good shape. I'd lost some weight. I was working out every day. Felt great, but one day I got really, really sick. And I felt sick all day. So in the evening, I called the nursing hotline. There is a, with my health insurance, there was a number that I could call and just say, hey, I've got a problem, what do you think? And they said, you need to go to the emergency room. So I drove myself to the emergency room. I left Sean at the house. And I sat by myself in that emergency room for some time and finally went back. And you know how the emergency room is slow. But all of a sudden, things started to move quickly. A whole team of people came rushing in. And a doctor and some nurses came, and they were hooking stuff up to me. And they said, Mr. Attwood, you've had a heart attack. Which is a shocking thing, because I'd always had a very, very healthy heart. Always been in great shape. And I was in the hospital for some time, and they did all kinds of tests on me, and nobody ever did figure out how I had a heart attack, but sure enough, I did have a heart attack. And it did some damage to my heart, but it all recovered, and I'm fine now. One of the theories is that I had a virus that attacked my heart, because I have no heart disease. I had no clogs. I had no surgery. I had to take no medicine afterwards, but I do remember a moment that I was about to have my heart scanned. What's that thing called? Where they what's that? Not an echocardiogram. The one where they send a camera all the way into your heart. What's that? Nobody can remember it. I should have written it down. I thought I would have remembered. But I was laying there. I was all alone. I was lying on a cold metal table waiting for the doctor to come in. And it occurred to me that my whole world had turned upside down and nothing made sense. And I had no reason to know whether I was going to live or die. And what shocked me in that moment, all by myself in that room awaiting that test, was that I wasn't afraid. I wasn't afraid. I remember praying and asking God to see me through this time, because at that time my older daughter was small, and I told the Lord I'd like to be able to take care of my daughter long enough to see her grown and on her own. And that's all I really want from you, God. I really felt no sense that I was a holy or a good person, or that there was any reason that God should send me to heaven besides the grace of his Son, but I had no fear that he wouldn't receive me on the basis of his love for me and nothing else. It changed my life, that moment, because I realized that if I wasn't afraid to die, then I had no reason to be afraid of anything else. And I realized that my peace would not be found in my health or my longevity or my success or anything else, but that peace that came to me in that very scary moment, because I felt God with me. Peter is standing on the water, looking at Jesus through the power of God. He is doing the impossible. And then he gets distracted and he looks around and he sees the waves and he begins to focus on the threat. His heart is weak and he begins to sink. And he cries out, Lord, save me. How many times have we faced the difficulties of this life and we've obsessed over the waves? We've obsessed over the news reports or the political polls, the number of COVID cases in our county, or the state of our relationships, or what the doctor said, or all these very real concerns. But in looking at the waves, our heart has become as stirred as the waters, and we feel ourselves sinking into fear and anxiety. Can remember a time years ago, it was the most challenging time in my life internally. And I was looking at all the different ways that my life wasn't going the way I wanted it to. And I would say, well, if I take this direction, this choice, then this is going to happen. And then the other. And as I would strategize on which direction I should take in my life, there was no good answer. This fork in the road led to a dead end, and this one led to catastrophe. And I felt utterly stuck. And I'd think, how do I manage this? What am I supposed to do? There were no answers. I was sinking. And so during that time in my life, I remember taking long, long walks and just pouring out my heart to God and just saying, Lord, have mercy. Lord, save me. Here's the truth. This is what I'm feeling. I reoriented my gaze towards Jesus Christ instead of my circumstances. God has been faithful. And we have to learn how to manage our fear and anxiety because it's many times that out of fear and anxiety we do great harm. We say, the catastrophe is coming, and we don't see the situation clearly, and we feel justified in doing things that do harm to ourselves and to others. Jesus has taught us, and our faith teaches us, our Methodist tradition teaches us to do no harm. You can't do no harm unless you can find peace in your spirit and clarity in your mind. We have a Lord who has conquered death. His name is above every name. His name is above COVID. And though these challenges are real, we have not been abandoned, and God is not surprised. And he has seen us through much more difficult times than these. We'd like to think of ourselves as heroes, as people who can drum up within ourselves the heart that it takes to be able to conquer the difficulties of life. But deep down underneath it, underneath that shell of outward confidence, we know that in and of ourselves we are not heroes and we are truly afraid. But that's okay, because we walk with a hero. And our strength of heart doesn't have to be our own. And in greater is the one who is in us than the one who is in the world. And he has called us to be part of building his new world of peace and justice and love and grace. And so, dear friends, as you walk through a dangerous world, be not afraid, for you are not alone. You are not alone. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. I invite you to sing your faith in a God who has not abandoned you, and God who is greater than all of our fears. It is well with my soul. May we sing all the verses.
Who has given you rest and peace will go with you as you leave this place. Feel the healing love of God in your life. Bring the good news of God's love to all whom you meet. Go in peace.